At the end of this training program, the residents should understand the basics of pulmonary functions, should be aware of pre-test evaluation, should have a clear understanding about the various maneuvers, and should become adept at interpreting pulmonary function testing. We will start by some history about the pulmonary function testing, know about when to order it, what are the prerequisites for having it done, know about various lung volumes and capacities being measured by this test. Then we will know about the various maneuvers and how they are being performed. We will know how to interpret a pulmonary function test. And then Dr. Vignesh will end with a case vignette and an interesting quiz. The birth of modern pulmonary function testing dates back to the mid-19th century. The Waters pyrometer was first discovered by Dr. Jonathan Hutchinson, a surgeon by profession, in 1846. He coined the term vital capacity and then published a paper regarding the relationship of the vital capacity to both age as well as height. Pulmonary function testing was first standardized by the American Thoracic Society in 1979, and since then they have released various guidelines and statements regarding the 6-minute walk test, the cardiopulmonary exercise testing, general standardization of spirometry, lung volumes, diffusion capacities, and absolute lung volume assessments. And recently, in 2014, they have come up with general standards with technical standards for field walking tests in patients with chronic respiratory disease. So what really happens when a patient is sent to our respiratory laboratory? We have a pre-test evaluation checklist in order to assess whether the individual could really perform the test or not. We start by inquiring about the demographic profile of the individual, which includes name, age, sex, height, and ethnicity of the patient. These variables have been significantly found to influence the lung functions. Let's take an example of measuring the forced vital capacity. When do you say that the forced vital capacity of an individual is normal? When would you say that it is abnormal? For this purpose, we have standard reference equations which would help us in predicting the normal vital capacity of a patient with respect to the above mentioned variables. If the patient's vital capacity is less than that of the predicted, we infer that his vital capacity is low. This is all about the importance of knowing the demographic profile. The basic clinical diagnosis of the patient is necessary so that we really know what to expect out of the pulmonary function testing. Information regarding smoking, intake of alcohol, and history of any drug intake will also be noted. With respect to the intake of drugs, for reversibility and provocation testing, if at all feasible, the patient should avoid the following drugs for a specified duration prior to the study. For example, short-acting beta agonists like salbutamol be avoided 12 hours prior. Short-acting muscarinic antagonists like ipratropium and leukotriene response modifiers like montelukast be avoided 24 hours prior. Long-acting beta agonists like salmeterol and theophyllines like doxophyllin be avoided 48 hours prior. And antihistaminic agents like cetirizine be avoided 72 hours prior to the study. Patients with active pulmonary infection, hemodynamic instability, as in a patient presenting to the emergency with acute exacerbation of chronic obstructive airway disease, history of myocardial infarction within the past 1 month, or history of ocular or cardiothoracic surgery within the past 1.5 years, are contraindications of performing a pulmonary function test. Also, patients with impaired mental states or a conscious patient with unbearable abdominal pain, chest pain, facial pain, or oral ulcers may find it really difficult to perform such complicated maneuvers, and these clinical conditions have to be taken into consideration before taking a patient for pulmonary function testing. As soon as we are convinced that the patient can be taken up for the test, he is asked to come up wearing loose clothes. He should avoid caffeine-based drinks on the day of the study. He should not have had alcohol 4 hours prior and smoking 1 hour prior to the study. There should be no intake of any large meal 2 hours prior or any vigorous exercise 30 minutes prior to the testing. So now Let's go and see what's happening inside our respiratory laboratory. Hi everyone, I'm Dr. Mithul and I'm at the respiratory laboratory in the Department of Medicine at AIIMS right now. And we have this PFT machine that we'll be demonstrating our work today on. And so let's have a look at the machine. This machine is comprised of five components. The first one is the monitor with the PFT suite software installed inside. The second component is the spirometer, which we call Dr. Quark. And the third part is the body box, used in the measurements of absolute lung volumes and body plethysmography. This is the fourth part. This is the cylinder. This cylinder contains compressed oxygen. This is also used for measurements of absolute lung volumes and body plethysmography. This one is the DLCO gas mixture, which contains methane at a concentration of 0.03%, carbon monoxide at a concentration of 0.31%, nitrogen and oxygen at a concentration of 21%, and the rest being comprised by nitrogen. This is used for the calculation of the diffusion lung capacity of carbon monoxide. Now, as you can see, these pipes, these are connected through these cylinders, and these are going through these pipes. The gas is coming to these machines, the spirometer machine and the plethysmography machine attached to the mic. And from here, these pipes are attached to the pneumotac device. Now, this is the pneumotac device. We can take it out. And this is the pneumotac device. This is the patient. This is the patient end, and this is the machine end. So now this is snugly fit inside, and this is the antibacterial filter that is attached to the patient end. These are the wires. This one is the sampling line. This one is for the mean inspiratory pressures and the mean expiratory pressure, that is the maximal respiratory pressures. And this is the connection coming from the gas cylinders directly to this, connected through a smart valve, which we have different use. Now, before we start this, before we start using the machine, we will first go on to calibrate the machine. Now, what do we mean by calibration? Calibration basically means the calibration of the pneumotac device in this current scenario. For that, we need to have a 3-liter syringe and the tubings. So when do we do the calibration? For every practical purpose, we have to calibrate the machine every day. Or if you're not using the machine for a long time, whenever you use the machine, that time we have to calibrate the machine. So now I will ask Dr. Vignesh to come and help me with the calibration. Dr. Vignesh, please. So Dr. Vignesh will be holding this 3-liter syringe and will be using it. Now, you have to ensure that the syringe, the piston is totally open and the syringe is full before you attach it to the device. Now, you have to attach it to the mouthpiece and ensure that the pneumotac is not loose so it might not fall. And now you come on to the PFT suit. You click on calibration and click on PNT-X9. Now, PNT-X9 is the name of this pneumotac device. So, as you can see, you have to click OK, give the computer the command, and it will check the hardware, and then it will instruct you. See, so there's noise detected this time. So you have to calibrate and go on to PXT-X9, click OK. It will again check the hardware and it will start the calibration. The computer will give us the command for breathing in the flow meter, that is using the syringe, taking the piston inside and outside, and allows Dr. Vignesh to do the same. So, air is going inside, coming out, inside and out through the piston. The piston will be put outside and inside, outside, inside, outside and inside, at a slow pace, not a very fast pace. And so still it will go inside and outside, maintaining a steady flow till the calibration is complete. So now we have the calibration results, and as you can see, the expiratory gain and inspiratory gain, the ranges for that are between 900 and 1200, and our tests are well within limit. So we have had a successful calibration. The machine is ready to use now. Hmm. While a person performs a quiet breathing, he or she inhales and exhales a particular amount of air which he is not aware of. This is known as the tidal breathing, and the volume of air being inhaled or exhaled during this breathing is called the tidal volume. So what is this inspiratory reserve volume? It is the amount of air that can be inhaled over and above the tidal volume. Similarly, the expiratory reserve volume is the volume of air expired over and above the tidal volume. The volume of air remaining in the lungs after a forceful expiration is known as the residual volume. The combination of two or more volumes gives us a capacity. First, let's talk about the vital capacity. It is nothing but the amount of air that can be maximally expired after a forceful inhalation. It is the combination of the inspiratory reserve volume, the tidal volume, and the expiratory reserve volume. The second capacity is the expiratory capacity, which is the amount of air that can be expired after a tidal inspiration. It is a combination of the expiratory reserve volume and the tidal volume. The third capacity is the inspiratory capacity, which is the amount of air that can be inspired after a tidal expiration. It is a combination of the inspiratory reserve volume and the tidal volume. The fourth capacity is the functional residual capacity, which is the volume of air remaining in the lungs after a tidal expiration. It is a combination of the expiratory reserve volume and the residual volume. The fifth and the final capacity is the total lung capacity, which is a combination of the inspiratory capacity and the functional residual capacity. We will understand the clinical implications of these three capacities while we discuss about the body plethysmography. There are various factors which may influence the lung volumes and capacities. Patients with extremes of age are known to have low vital capacities. A short-looking African-American female has been found to have low lung capacities as compared to a tall non-African-American male. Vital capacity changes with posture. Normally, there is a decline in the vital capacity from standing to supine position by a difference not more than 10%. Patients with diaphragmatic dysfunction can even have worse decline in vital capacity beyond 10%. Respiratory muscle strength is an important factor that influences lung capacities. Patients with respiratory muscle weakness may have a decline in lung capacities. Apart from these physiological conditions, the technique of performing the pulmonary function test and the disease states affect these capacities. Before going into the details regarding laboratory assessment of pulmonary functions, let us not forget the bedside pulmonary function tests that have been in clinical practice for a long period of time. The commonly used tests are the breath holding test, the single breath count, coughing after a deep breath, and the candle blowing test. In the breath holding test, we ask the patient to hold his breath for as much time as he can. A person with a normal cardiopulmonary reserve can hold his breath for at least 25 seconds. In the single breath count, the individual is asked to count from 1 to as much as possible in a single breath. A healthy adult can count up to 30 to 40 numbers in a single breath. Before the advent of modern spirometry, residents used to carry candles in their pockets. Let us find out why. The candle blowing test measures the maximum breathing capacity. In this test, we ask the patient to blow on an illuminated candle from a distance of 6 inches. With the mouth wide open, the chin being rested on the table, ensuring that there is no head movement, blowing a candle at a distance of 6 inches indicates that the patient has a maximum breathing capacity greater than 60 liters per minute and a forced expiratory volume and the first second of expiration greater than 1.6 liters. Next to the bedside assessment of pulmonary function comes the laboratory assessment of pulmonary function. This includes spirometry, tests of absolute lung volume measurements, tests of gas exchange, and tests of cardiopulmonary interaction. The tests of cardiopulmonary interaction include the 6-minute walk test and the cardiopulmonary exercise testing. The first maneuver that we perform in a person who has come for spirometry is a slow vital capacity maneuver called the SVC maneuver of spirometry. The slow vital capacity is the vital capacity measured during a slow and deep breathing. It could be either an inspiratory vital capacity, which is the volume of air that is inhaled after a maximal expiration, or an expiratory vital capacity, which is the volume of air that is exhaled out after a maximal inspiration. In clinical practice, we commonly use the expiratory vital capacity. Now let's look at how the procedure is done.
Namaskar, mera naam Dr. Mitul hai aur aaj main aapke phefde ki jaanch karne wala hu. Is jaanch ke dauran yadi kabhi bhi aapke aankhon ke samne dhundlapan chhaye ya fir aapko chakkar aaye to aapko turant batana hai, hum aapki jaanch ko tabhi sthagit kar denge. Aapko bilkul bhi ghabrane ki zarurat nahi hai is jaanch mein, theek hai? तो इस जांच के दौरान हमें क्या करना है कि ये माउथ पीस है, ये आप ले लीजिए, ये आपका माउथ पीस है, इसको रखिए, इसको आपको अपने मुंह में लगाना है। देखिए इसके दो हिस्से हैं, ये मोटे वाला है और ये पतले वाला है। चलो पतले वाला हिस्सा है उसको आपको अपने मुंह में लेना है। देखिए ऐसे लेना है, ये आपको अपने दांतों के बीच में रखना है, पहली बात। दूसरी बात यह है कि आपको अपने होठों को बंद करना है इसके चारों तरफ, ताकि कोई भी हवा बाहर ना निकल रही हो, और अपनी जीभ को इसके पीछे नहीं लगा के इसके नीचे रखना है। देखिए ऐसे। अब इस दौरान मैं आपके नाक के ऊपर ये वाला नोज क्लिप लगा दूंगा, ताकि आपकी नाक से बाहर सांस निकलनी बंद हो जाएगी, तो सारी की सारी जो हवा है वो आपके शरीर से इस फिल्टर के जरिए मशीन में चली जाएगी। ठीक है, क्या आप समझ गए? चलिए फिर करके देखिए, मैं आपके नोज क्लिप लगा दूंगा। करिए, नोज क्लिप लगा दिया आपको, सांस लीजिए लीजिए, कोई घबराहट तो महसूस नहीं हो रही आपको? लगाना तो सीख ही गए हैं, तो आइए हम आपकी पहली जांच शुरू करते हैं। पहली जांच जो हम आपकी करेंगे उसको हम एसवीसी कहते हैं। एसवीसी का मतलब स्लो वाइटल कैपेसिटी होता है। ज्यादा कुछ घबराने की जरूरत नहीं है आपको इसमें, थोड़ा बहुत बस जो मैं बोलूंगा आप मेरी बात सुनिएगा तो आपकी जाँच बिल्कुल सही हो जाएगी। ठीक है, तो इसमें आपको क्या करना है, देखिए पहले बस मेरे हाथ को देखिए, धीरे धीरे पहले नॉर्मल सांस लेनी, नॉर्मल सांस छोड़नी, नॉर्मल सांस लेनी, नॉर्मल सांस छोड़नी, नॉर्मल सांस लेनी, नॉर्मल सांस छोड़नी, उसके बाद पूरी ताकत के साथ धीरे 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 लंबी सांस खींचनी है, खींचनी है, खींचनी है, जब तक खींचनी है तब तक, जब तक कि आपके फेफड़े सारे के सारे पूरे भर ना जाए, और उसके बाद धीरे 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 छोड़नी है, छोड़नी है, और छोड़ते ही रहनी है तब तक जब तक आपके फेफड़े जो है बिल्कुल खाली ना हो जाए, उसके बाद आप साधारण सांस ले सकते हैं। आइए
before interpreting any maneuver of the pulmonary function testing, we need to know whether the maneuver was performed properly. For the same, the American Thoracic Society has published statements regarding acceptability and repeatability criteria for each of these maneuvers. In acceptability criteria, we have a set of characteristics to say that the maneuver is acceptable. If the curve is acceptable as per the criteria, we move on repeating the maneuvers until a specified number of curves are obtained. Each of these maneuvers may be tiring for the patient, and hence the American Thoracic Society has also specified time interval between repeating these maneuvers. After reaching the minimum number of acceptable curves, We need to analyze if all these curves go hand in hand. For this purpose, we have a set of repeatability criteria for each of these maneuvers. Now let's see if the slow vital capacity maneuver that we performed meets the acceptability and repeatability criteria. As we look at the graph of the S3C maneuver, we have time span in seconds plotted in the x-axis and volume of air in liters in the y-axis. As you can see in this maneuver, Dr. Vignesh has performed a good tidal breathing to achieve a baseline functional reservoir capacity and has inspired deeply and slowly to reach a plateau lasting for less than 1 second and started exhaling deeply and slowly to reach a plateau again below the baseline without any artifacts. Hence we can say that this SVC curve is acceptable. When we look at the SVC curve, we have two important capacities to look for. One is the inspiratory capacity, which includes the tidal volume and the inspiratory reserve volume, and the other, the expiratory vital capacity, which includes the inspiratory reserve volume, the tidal volume and the expiratory reserve volume. We can do these maneuvers for a maximum number of 4 attempts, giving at least 1 minute between each of these attempts, so that we get at least 3 acceptable curves. If the expiratory vital capacity given by 2 out of the 3 acceptable maneuvers with the largest value is not more than 150 ml, the repeatability criteria is satisfied. The maximum volume of the expiratory vital capacity of these reported 3 acceptable curves is known as the slow vital capacity. The mean inspiratory capacity of all these 3 curves is taken for reporting the inspiratory capacity. This table shows the expiratory vital capacity and the inspiratory capacity of the 3 acceptable curves. The largest 2 values of the expiratory vital capacity are 4.42 liters and 4.37 liters. The difference between which is 50 ml, which is less than 150 ml. Hence, the SVC maneuvers is repeatable. In order to report the SVC, we take the largest value of the 3 attempts, which in this case is 4.42 liters. That is 86% of predicted values and is above the lower limit of normal. In order to say if a particular volume or capacity is well within the normal limits, they should lie between the 95th percentile and the 5th percentile of mean in a binomial distribution curve. If a capacity is less than 5th percentile of the mean, which is known as the lower limit of normal, the capacity is said to be reduced. If on the other hand, the capacity is lying above the 95th percentile of the mean, also called as the upper limit of normal, it is said to be increased. In this scenario, the slow vital capacity is 86% of predicted and is well within the 5th and the 95th percentile of normal. The mean of all the 3 acceptable curves is 3.01 liters, which is used as the inspiratory capacity in body bathysmography. Coming to the second maneuver of spirometry, which is the forced vital capacity or the FVC maneuver. FVC is the vital capacity that is measured during a forceful breathing. Let us see how the maneuver is performed.
और अब हम आपकी दूसरी जांच करेंगे, इसको हम FVC कहते हैं, जिसका पूरा नाम forced vital capacity होता है, ठीक है? इसमें ज़्यादा कुछ नहीं करना है आपको, जैसे आपने पहले मेरी बात सुनी थी और आपने किया था, वैसे ही इस बार भी आपको करना है। तो शुरुआत कैसे करेंगे हम इसकी? पहले आपको साधारण सांस लेनी है, साधारण सांस लेनी है, और फिर जब मैं आपको बोलूंगा कि जोर से लंबी गहरी सांस लीजिए, तब आपको जोर लगा के, पूरा जोर लगा के एक लंबी गहरी सांस लेनी है, और फिर साथ ही साथ उसको जोर से बाहर निकाल के बाहर निकालनी है, ठीक है? निकालते ही रहनी है, 6 सेकंड तक निकालनी है, और उसके बाद मैं आपको फिर से जोर से लंबी सांस खींचने के लिए बोलूंगा, तब आपको जोर से लंबी सांस खींचनी है और तब आपका टेस्ट पूरा हो जाएगा। समझ गए आप?
As we perform the forced vital capacity maneuver, two kinds of curves get plotted up. The first one is the flow volume curve, in which the flow rate in liters per second is plotted in the y-axis and the lung volume in liters plotted in the x-axis. The second one is the volume time curve, with the time span in seconds plotted on the x-axis and the lung volume in liters plotted in the y-axis. To analyze the FVC curve, let us follow an algorithm similar to what we followed in the SVC maneuver. To say that the volume time curve of this FVC maneuver is acceptable, it should have a good start without any artifacts created because of hesitation, cuffing, submaximal effort, air leak, or an obstructed mouthpiece. In addition to a good start, the exhalation also has to be satisfactory. That is, the duration of exhalation should last more than 6 seconds. If the duration of exhalation lasts less than 6 seconds, at least the plateau in the volume time curve should be more than 1 second. There should not be any artifacts due to early termination or glottic closure. Now, as you can see in this volume time curve, there is a good start without any artifacts. There is a satisfactory exhalation lasting more than 6 seconds. Hence, this volume time curve meets the acceptability criteria for the FVC maneuver. Before proceeding further, let us have a close look at the flow volume loop. In the flow volume loop, any event happening below the baseline is an inspiratory event and above the baseline is an expiratory event, which is exactly opposite to what we observe in a patient on positive pressure mechanical ventilation. What do you infer from the flow volume loop? As you can see, in this flow volume loop, the subject has performed a tidal respiration initially. At the end of the tidal expiration, he has taken a deep forceful inspiration, which was immediately followed by a deep forceful expiration. So when you consider the expiratory part of the FVC maneuver, in the early part of the expiratory limb, there is a steep rise in the flow rate, whereas in the later part of the limb, the flow rate starts declining, declining, and declining to zero. Another important inference that we draw is that the earlier part of the limb is an effort-dependent process, and the later part of the limb is effort-independent. The maximal expiratory flow rate reached during the forceful expiration is the peak exploratory flow rate, abbreviated as the PEF. The flow rate at the point of expiration, when 75% of the vital capacity is remaining in the lungs, is the maximum expiratory flow, that is the MEF 75%. The expiratory flow rate, when only 25% of vital capacity is remaining in the lungs, is called the maximum expiratory flow rate, MEF 25%. The expiratory flow rate at the mid-expiration is called as the MEF 50. Similarly, the inspiratory flow rate at mid-inspiration is the MIF 50. Till now, we were in a state of euphoria looking at all the normal curves. But in a real-life situation, we face difficulties because of generation of unacceptable curves. The most common cause of production of unacceptable curves is an improper counseling given to the patient prior to testing. What do you see in the first flow volume loop? In spite of a good tidal respiration and a forceful inspiratory effort, the patient was hesitant to start, which is indicated by a small fluctuation in the flow volume curve. This is called as a hesitant start. If the fluctuation in the curve results in the drop of flow rate more than 50% of what it had reached, as in the case of the second curve, where the expiratory flow rate after reaching a maximum of 4.5 liter per second dropped down to zero, which was again followed by a forceful expiration, this means that the patient has cuffed at the first second of expiration. Look at the third curve, wherein neither the expiratory nor the inspiratory effort was good enough to meet the acceptability criteria. So what do you see in the fourth curve? In this volume time curve, इवन दो द पेशेंट हैड अ गुड स्टार्ट द पेशेंट डिड नॉट हैव अ सेटिस्फैक्ट्री एक्सिलेशन नाइदर द ड्यूरेशन ऑफ एक्सिलेशन लास्टेड मोर देन 6 सेकेंड्स नॉट डिड ही रीच अ प्लेटो विच मीन्स अ प्रीमेच्योर टर्मिनेशन. Look at the last flow volume and the volume time curve. In the flow volume loop, as the flow rate started declining, there was an abrupt cutoff even when 25% of the vital capacity had not been exhaled onto. In the simultaneously acquired volume time curve, there appears to be a plateau formation in the first second of exhalation, which is practically impossible. This means that the patient had closed his glottis prior to complete exhalation. We can do these maneuvers for a maximum number of 8 attempts, giving at least a time interval of 1 minute between each attempt to generate at least 3 acceptable curves. In order to meet the repeatability criteria, let us look at the example below. If we consider the forced vital capacity of all the 3 acceptable curves, the two largest vital capacity are 4.68 liters and 4.65 liters. The difference between them being 30 ml, which is less than the recommended 150 ml. Similarly, FEV1, 3.85 liter and 3.78 liters, that is the difference is less than 150 ml. Hence, the repeatability criteria has been met. So which curve out of these three will be taken for interpretation? The curve with the largest sum of the FEV1 and the FPC, that is the first curve, will be taken for interpretation. As we discussed earlier, the vital capacity maneuvers are used to differentiate between obstructive and restrictive lung diseases. The basic pathology in obstructive lung diseases is airway obstruction that leads to increased airway resistance. The basic pathology in restrictive lung disorders is parenchymal or extraparenchymal damage leading to reduced compliance. So in a patient with obstructive lung disease like COPD or asthma, the forced vital capacity is usually normal but may be decreased in cases of severe obstruction. But in cases of restrictive lung diseases, the forced vital capacity is decreased or may be normal in early stages of restriction. Look at this figure. In a normal healthy adult, during forceful expiration, the elastic pull exerted over the terminal bronchioles prevent the airway collapse. In patients with chronic obstructive airway disease, due to loss of elastic tissues, there is an increase in the tendency of airflow obstruction during forceful expiration with a maintained flow during inspiration. So this concept of dynamic airway collapse occurring only during expiration is very important in patients with obstructive lung disorders. This dynamic airway collapse is more frequent with forceful expiration rather than slow expiration. So in patients with chronic obstructive airway disease, even in spite of having low forced vital capacity, the slow vital capacity which could still be normal, whereas in patients with restriction, the slow vital capacity is always reduced. So what are the variables assessed in the forced vital capacity and the slow vital capacity maneuver? First of all, we have the forced expiratory volume in the first second, that is the FEV1, and it is if a decline in FEV1 suggests obstruction. Then we have the forced vital capacity, the FVC, and it is decreased in cases of restriction as well as there in severe obstruction. The slow vital capacity, the SVC, is decreased in cases of restriction. The ratio of FEV1 to FVC, that is the ratio of the forced expiratory volume in the first second to that of the forced vital capacity, a decrease in this ratio indicates obstruction because there has been a relative more decline in FEV1 as compared to the FVC. Now coming on to the peak expiratory flow rate, the PEFR, a decline in this parameter suggests obstruction. The PEF 25 to 75, that is the peak expiratory flow rate from 25% to 75% of expiration, suggests a small airway disease and it is the earliest markers in patients with small airway disease. or might just be a normal variant as it is in 40% of the patients. The MEF50 means maximum expiratory flow at mid expiration, and the MIF50 means the maximum inspiratory flow at mid inspiration, and we'll be dealing with this in the upcoming slides. These are the typical flow volume curves what we see in patients with normal, obstructive and restrictive lung diseases. In the case of obstruction, as compared to the normal loop, there is a decline in the peak expiratory flow rate and additional scooping seen in the later phase of the forceful expiration. This is a classical flow volume loop suggestive of obstructive pattern seen in patients with chronic obstructive airway disease. In patients with restrictive lung diseases, the flow volume curve appears to look like a miniature of the normal flow volume loop, and they are found to have a supranormal flow rate in spite of the drastic reduction in the forced vital capacity. This is suggestive of a restrictive pattern. So how do we interpret the FVC or the SVC maneuver? First of all, we will look at the FEV1 by VC ratio. Now you must be wondering which vital capacity to choose from. Why, either it could be the FVC or the SVC. But in order to choose a vital capacity, the largest of the two is taken. Now we look at the FEV1 by VC ratio. If that ratio is normal, we look at the vital capacity. If that is also normal, that means that we have a normal vital capacity maneuver. But in spite of a normal FEV1 by VC, if we get a reduced vital capacity, that means that there is a possible restriction. If the FEV1 by VC ratio is reduced, then we again look at the vital capacity. If the vital capacity is normal, in spite of an FEV1 by VC reduction, that means it is a pure obstruction. But if the FEV1 by VC is reduced and the vital capacity is also reduced, then that means that we are looking either at a severe obstruction or at an obstruction with a possible restriction. So now let's interpret this FVC maneuver. For this particular patient, the SVC of the same individual was 4.4 liters. Hence, we have chosen the FVC. We first look at the FEV1 by FVC ratio. In this case, it is 83% and it is well above the lower limit of normal. Next, we see the forced vital capacity, which is also well above the lower limit of normal, concluding it as a normal FVC maneuver. So whenever we find an obstructive pattern in a baseline FVC maneuver, we see the response to bronchodilators. For this, we administer metered-dose inhaler of salbutamol with a Spatzer's device at 100 microgram per actuation, and we give it every 30 seconds for 4 times. And then we judge the response to bronchodilators after repeating the FVC maneuver after 15 minutes. If there is an increase in the FEV1 and or FVC by greater than 12% or 200 ml, it is suggestive of significant bronchodilation. Now let us have a look at these flow volume loops. The red one is the baseline FVC maneuver. In this we can see that there is a decrease in the peak expiratory flow rate, as well as there is scooping in the later phase of forceful expiration. The blue curve is that of the post bronchodilator curve, where we can see that there is an apparent increase in the peak expiratory flow rate as well as a decline in the scooping, suggestive of bronchodilation. So to confirm our findings, we have to see the various parameters. Now we first see the FEV1 by FVC ratio. As you can see that it is below the lower limit of normal. So we will compare the force vital capacity. The force vital capacity is above the lower limit of normal, and this is suggestive of obstruction. Such a case, we will next see the forced expiratory volume in the first second, that is the FEV1, and the pre-bronchodilator curve is suggestive of a decrease in FEV1, whereas now we will compare with the post-bronchodilator curve, where we can see that there is a significant increase of 23.6%, which confirms the finding of bronchodilation. That means this is an obstructive disease with significant bronchodilation. How to assess the severity of obstruction? We use the post-bronchodilator FEV1 for measuring the severity of obstruction. There are two guidelines that have come up, the ATS-ERS and the GOLD. The ATS-ERS is classified into mild, moderate, moderately severe, severe and very severe, depending upon various percentages of the FEV1 predicted. And the GOLD that came up in 2014, the Global Initiative Against Obstructive Lung Disease, have characterized it as mild, moderate, severe or very severe. The commonly found obstructive lung diseases include those that involve the lower airways. But however uncommon they might be, there are patients with upper airway obstruction. So when we consider an airway, the larynx and the upper half of the trachea lies outside the thorax, and the lower half of the trachea along with the mainstream bronchus lies inside the thorax. During inspiration, a negative intrapleural pressure is generated which sucks in air through the large airways. This leads to a tendency to collapse of the extrathoracic airways. On the other hand, during expiration, a positive pleural pressure has a tendency to collapse the intrathoracic airways. So, for example, a patient with bilateral vocal cord palsy, due to impaired abduction of the vocal cords, the upper airways collapse during forceful inspiration but remain patent during expiration. Hence, we call the obstruction as variable extrathoracic obstruction. Similarly, if we take an example of a patient with bronchial adenoma, an endobronchial lesion partially occluding the bronchi, the narrowed intrathoracic airway collapse completely during a forceful expiration but remain patent during inspiration. Hence we call the obstruction as variable intrathoracic obstruction. With variable intrathoracic obstruction with a defective expiration, there is flattening of the expiratory limb of the flow volume loop. Whereas in a patient with variable extrathoracic obstruction where there is defective inspiration, there is flattening of the inspiratory limb of the flow volume loop, like a patient with vocal cord palsy. But what happens in a patient with tracheal stenosis where there is defective inspiration as well as expiration? So there is flattening of both the inspiratory as well as expiratory limb of the flow volume loop. Now we look at the peak expiratory flow rate. See, because there is a defect in the expiration, in case of a variable intrathoracic obstruction, example bronchial adenoma, the peak expiratory flow rate is decreased. As well as in case of fixed extrathoracic obstruction like tracheal stenosis, because of the defective expiration, there is decrease in the peak expiratory flow rate. However, this is preserved in case such as vocal cord palsy where there is a variable extrathoracic obstruction leading to a defective inspiration. Now, the most important ratio that we have here to differentiate between the three conditions is the MIF 50, with the MIF 50, that is the maximal inspiratory flow at mid-inspiration, ratio of that to the maximal expiratory flow at mid-expiration. Since there is a defective expiration only, in case of variable intrathoracic obstruction, this ratio is greater than 1. And in case of variable extrathoracic obstruction, because of a defective inspiration, this ratio is less than 1. And in a case of fixed extrathoracic obstruction, where there is defective inspiration as well as expiration, this ratio is 1. It is very useful tool. It is used in the detection of hyperreactive airways if there is a history suggestive of asthma with a normal spirometry and no reversibility, if there is episodic chest tightness with cough but no evidence of any VEs, if there is chronic cough which is often worse at night but without any VEs, or if there is unexplained dyspnea or recurrent episodes of cold, bronchitis or recurrent pneumonia which does not occur in the same lung region, you should opt for bronchoprovocative testing. First, we evaluate the baseline spirometry. If the forced expiratory volume is greater than 70%, then we administer methacholine by customized nebulizers. We start at a concentration of 0.03 mg per ml, and at increasing concentrations, we have to go up to 16 mg per ml as per requirement. After administration of methacholine, we repeat the spirometry 30 seconds and after 90 seconds of each nebulization, and we look for the decline in the FEV1. If that is greater than 20%, that means that there is bronchial hyper-responsiveness present. That means that this is a positive test, so we have to calculate the provocative concentration 20, that is the PC20, which is calculated by complex equations. But if there is the decline in FEV1 is less than 20%, then we repeat after every 5 minutes with increasing concentrations till we go on to a concentration of 16 mg per ml, and after which we have to stop. The respiratory effort of the patient, let's have a look at how it is done.
अब हम आपकी तीसरी जांच करेंगे जिसको हम MVV कहते हैं। MVV का मतलब मैक्सिमल वॉलंटरी वेंटिलेशन होता है, ठीक है। तो इसमें आपको ज्यादा कुछ नहीं करना है, जैसे आपने पहले मुंह में माउथ पीस लगाया था उसको आप मुंह में लगा लेंगे, नोज क्लिप लगा देंगे, और उसके बाद तेज सांस लेंगे, गहरी सांस छोड़ेंगे, तेज सांस लेंगे, तेज सांस छोड़ेंगे, गहरी सांस लेंगे, गहरी सांस छोड़ेंगे, और सांस लेंगे छोड़ेंगे, सांस लेंगे छोड़ेंगे, सांस लेंगे छोड़ेंगे, और ऐसा 12 सेकंड तक करेंगे। और 12 सेकंड के बाद फिर मैं आपको बोलूंगा कि अब आप इसको बंद कर दीजिए। अब आप बंद कर देंगे और मैं आपको करके दिखाता हूँ कि आपको क्या करना है। देखिए, नोज क्लिप लगा लिया, ऐसे कर।
Let us now have a look at the MVV curve of the test just performed. We can see that the subject has taken deep breaths and as fast as possible. So, as a result, he has generated the amplitude greater than 50% of the vital capacity, and he has had 19 breaths in 12 seconds, which meets the acceptability criteria for this MVV curve. So how do we select the curves in case of MVV? Currently, there are no recommendations for the maximum number of attempts and the time between each attempts in case of maximum voluntary ventilation. But still, we prefer having 3 attempts to generate 2 acceptable curves. The repeatability criteria states that the MVV between the curves should not differ by more than 20%. Let's look at the example that we have. The attempt number 1, we had 139.5 liter per minute was the MVV, and for the second, the MVV was 126.4. So the difference in both was 10%. So this meets our repeatability criteria and these curves are repeatable. The curve with the largest MVV is selected for reporting. So in this case, we will select the one with 139.5, that is the attempt number 1 will be selected for that. And we can also see that both of them are well above the lower limit of normal. That means the MVV is normal. The MVV by FEV1 ratio greater than 0.32 indicates good effort and normal muscle strength. But the issue is that it has a high negative predicted value. That means a normal MVV goes against the presence of muscle weakness, But low MBV does not necessarily mean that the patient has a poor respiratory muscle strength. The maximal respiratory pressures, they are the two maximal respiratory pressures, the maximal inspiratory pressure and the maximal expiratory pressure. They are similar to the MBV maneuver in the fact that they are also used in the assessment of respiratory muscle strength. Now let's go and see how these are performed.
आपकी चौथी जांच करेंगे, इसका नाम MIP होता है, इसका मतलब maximum inspiratory pressure होता है। तो बहुत ज़्यादा मुश्किल जांच नहीं है, इसमें बस आपको पहले साधारण सांस लेनी है, साधारण सांस छोड़नी है, साधारण सांस लेनी है, साधारण सांस छोड़नी है, साधारण सांस लेनी है, फिर धीरे 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 सारी की सारी सांस छोड़ देनी है। जब सारी की सारी सांस छोड़ देंगे तो उसके बाद तक आवाज आएगी, वो आवाज इस मशीन के शटर के बंद होने की आवाज है। शटर बंद हो जाएगा तो ना हवा बाहर जाएगी ना हवा अंदर आएगी, ठीक है। तो उसके बाद आपको लंबी सांस लेने की कोशिश करनी है, तब तक करनी है जब तक वो शटर खुल जाए। वो शटर थोड़ी देर में अपने आप ही खुल जाएगा, और जब ऐसा हो जाएगा तो उसके बाद आपको साधारण सांस लेनी शुरू कर देनी। आप समझ गए? अब हम आपकी पांचवी जांच करेंगे, इस जांच का नाम MEP है। MEP का मतलब मैक्सिमम एक्सपिरेटरी प्रेशर होता है। तो इस जांच में आपको पहले साधारण सांस लेनी है, साधारण सांस छोड़नी है, साधारण सांस लेनी है, साधारण सांस छोड़नी है, साधारण सांस लेनी है, साधारण सांस छोड़नी है, फिर एक लंबी गहरी सांस लेनी है, लेनी है, लेनी है, लेनी है, लेते ही रहनी है। जब आप पूरी लंबी गहरी सांस ले लेंगे उसके बाद आपको टक आवाज आएगी, जो वापस इस शटर के खुलने और बंद होने की आवाज है। तो अभी आपका शटर बंद हो जाएगा, जब शटर बंद हो जाएगा तो उसके बाद आपको कोशिश करना है कि आप जोर से तेजी से सांस सारी की सारी बाहर निकालें। तो जब आप ऐसा करेंगे तो शटर थोड़ी देर में अपने आप खुल जाएगा और उसके बाद आप साधारण सांस ले सकते हैं। ठीक, क्या बात समझ गए?
हाँ जी।
Now let us have a look at the maximal respiratory pressure curves. In these curves, we have pressure in centimeter of water on the y-axis and time span in seconds on the x-axis. So, in case of maximal inspiratory pressure, when the subject has had a forceful inspiration against a closed shutter at the residual volume, we can see that the subject has produced a sustained negative pressure which lasted greater than 1.5 seconds. That means it is an optimal MIP curve. Similarly, the patient produced a sustained increase in the positive pressure which lasted greater than 1.5 seconds in the maximal expiratory pressure curve, where he had taken a forceful expiration against closed shutter at the total lung capacity. What we also have to remember in this particular curve, that the inspiratory pressures are negative pressures and the expiratory pressures are positive pressures. The utility of maximal respiratory pressures is that they are used to assess the respiratory muscle strength. The maximal inspiratory pressure is a function of the diaphragm and the other inspiratory muscles, whereas the maximal expiratory pressure is a function of the expiratory muscles. An isolated decline in the maximal inspiratory pressure indicates diaphragmatic dysfunction, whereas an isolated decline in maximal expiratory pressure, which is theoretically possible, is rare. And also, a decrease in both the maximal inspiratory as well as the expiratory pressure indicates that either there is a generalized muscle weakness or the subject has had a poor effort. After having a detailed discussion on spirometry, we now move on to the test of absolute lung volume measurement. The absolute lung volumes are a measurement of the total lung capacity. The fallacy with spirometry is that it cannot measure any capacity that includes the residual volume. Now we have two capacities which include the residual volume, and those are the functional residual capacity, the FRC, and the total lung capacity, that is the TLC. The functional residual capacity is a combination of the residual volume as well as the expiratory reserve volume, and the total lung capacity is a combination of the functional residual capacity and the inspiratory capacity. Now for knowing the total lung capacity, we have to know the functional residual capacity as well as the inspiratory capacity. The inspiratory capacity can be known from the SVC maneuver, and for the measurement of FRC we use the lung volume assessment methods. The techniques used to measure the total lung capacity include the most accurate one, that is the body plethysmography, the one that we are using at our institute, the nitrogen washout method, the inert gas dilution methods that include the helium gas dilution method, and the radiological techniques. Another important value that we get from body plethysmography is the airway resistance, that is, it is known as RAW, and it is the ratio of the difference between the alveolar driving pressure and the mouth pressure to that of the flow rate. It is elevated both in obstructive lung diseases as well as states of hyperinflation. Now let us see how body plethysmography is done.
Now we will check our second test. को हम बॉडी प्लेथिस्मोग्राफी करते हैं और हम इसे इस बॉक्स के अंदर करेंगे। इस बॉक्स को बॉडी बॉक्स कहते हैं। तो इसमें आपको जैसे आप पहले कर रहे थे फिल्टर लगा रहे थे, नोज क्लिप लगा रहे थे, उसके बाद सांस ले रहे थे, बस फर्क ये है कि इसमें आप अपने हथेलियों को अपने गाल पे रखेंगे ताकि जब आप सांस लेंगे तो आपकी गाल ना फूले। तो ऐसे करके दिमाग नहीं लगाना कि 60 है, 70 है, 80 है, क्या है, मगर आपको मेरे हाथ को देखना है। जब मैं आपको एक बोलूंगा तो आपको सांस अंदर लेनी है, दो बोलूंगा सांस छोड़नी है। तो एक दो, एक दो, एक दो। जब आप ऐसे सांस ले रहे होंगे तब थोड़ी देर बाद अंदर शटर बंद हो जाएगा, तो शटर बंद होने के आपको आवाज सुनाई देगी, तो उस समय आपको घबराना नहीं है। जैसे पहले आप 60 प्रति मिनट की रफ्तार से सांस ले रहे थे, वैसे ही अभी आपको सांस लेके कंटिन्यू रखना है। क्या आप मेरी बात समझ गए?
Now let's analyze this body plethysmography curve. This curve is a volume time curve with time in seconds on the x-axis plotted against volume in liters on the y-axis. As we can see, the subject has started panting with an open shutter, breathing fast and quiet at a rate of around 60 per minute. After 4 to 5 pants, the resistance as well as the specific resistance is measured. The subject continues to pant and then the thoracic gas volume is measured, which is actually the functional residual capacity as measured by the body plethysmography. The repeatability criteria for body plethysmography is quite complex. We see the difference between the highest and the lowest FRC be divided by the mean FRC. That gives us a ratio which should be less than 0.05 for our three acceptable curves to be considered repeatable. Finally, the mean FRC is reported. And after getting the mean FRC, we have to add it to the inspiratory capacity to generate the TLC. Moving on to the interpretation of body plethysmography, we had three attempts. The FRC measured was 2.78, 2.8 and 2.67 liters respectively. The calculated mean FRC was 2.725 liters. For the repeatability criteria, the measured ratio was 0.04, which is less than 0.05. That meant that our three acceptable curves were repeatable. The mean inspiratory capacity that we had derived earlier from the SVC maneuver was 3.01 liters, and as a result, we could calculate the total lung capacity to be 5.735 liters, which was greater than the lower limit of normal, and so we had a normal TLC. The total lung capacity could be normal, it could be increased, and it would suggest possible hyperinflation. It would be reduced and that would suggest restriction. We now move on to the diffusion lung capacity for carbon monoxide. Which is the best gas for measuring the diffusion lung capacity? The gas should be readily available, it should be easily measurable, and the transfer should be diffusion limited rather than perfusion limited. Now oxygen and N2O, they exhibit a perfusion limited transfer and not a diffusion limited transfer, and hence they underestimate the diffusion lung capacity, so they are not used. Whereas carbon monoxide, which exhibits a diffusion limited transfer, is the ideal gas to measure the diffusion lung capacity. Now what happens to carbon monoxide as it crosses the alveolar wall? It comes in contact with the pulmonary surfactant, from where it reaches the alveolar epithelium, crosses the alveolar interstitium, and through the capillary endothelium, the pulmonary capillary endothelium, it reaches the plasma, where it gets bound to the hemoglobin on the RBCs. Any disease causing alveolar destruction, such as emphysema, thickening of the interstitium, such as interstitial lung diseases, obliteration of the pulmonary vasculature, such as pulmonary artery hypertension, or that causing a decrease in the hemoglobin concentration, namely anemia, that would lead to decrease in the diffusion of carbon monoxide across the alveolar wall. So what are the indications of the diffusion lung capacity of carbon monoxide? We use it for severity assessment in patients with restrictive lung diseases, such as ILD. It is used for the diagnosis of pulmonary vascular diseases in a background where there is normal hemoglobin, a normal vital capacity, as well as a normal total lung capacity. We detect isolated decrease in the DLCO, which would suggest a disease of the pulmonary vasculature. It is used for the differentiation of parenchymal and extraparenchymal restriction. It is also used for the diagnosis of early ILD in high-risk patients, where we expect a normal vital capacity as well as a total lung capacity. There are various physiological factors that alter DLCO. It decreases as age progresses. It is low in females, especially those of African American descent. It is high in obese individuals, and obesity is the only restrictive disorder with an increased diffusion lung capacity for carbon monoxide. It is low in patients with anemia, and as a result, we have to enter the value of the hemoglobin in the PFT machine for correcting the DLCO with respect to the hemoglobin levels. Increase in the carboxyhemoglobin levels decrease the DLCO. So smokers are asked to avoid smoking at least 2 hours prior to testing. If feasible, we should also get a carboxyhemoglobin level done. Posture and state of activity, they also affect the DLCO, as in from sitting to supine position and during a state of exertion, there is increase in the pulmonary blood flow leading to an increase in the DLCO. DLCO is high in the morning and changes with the menstrual cycle, it being highest on the day prior to menses and lowest on the fifth day of menses. The various methods used for calculation of the diffusion capacity include the single breath method, the steady state method, the rebreathing method, the three gas iteration method, and the intra breath method. Of these, the single breath method is the best standardized and the most validated method. But the problem with the single breath method is that the patient is asked to hold a breath for 10 seconds, and many of our patients feel it difficult to hold the breath for that long. Now let's move on to see how DLCO is calculated by the single breath method.
अब हम आपकी आखिरी जांच करेंगे, इसे हम DLCO कहते हैं। इसका मतलब डिफ्यूजन लंग कैपेसिटी ऑफ कार्बन मोनोऑक्साइड होता है। तो इसमें आपको पहले साधारण सांस लेनी है, साधारण सांस छोड़नी है, साधारण सांस लेनी है, साधारण सांस छोड़नी है, फिर एक लंबी गहरी सांस लेनी है, फिर उसको लंबी गहरी सांस को लंबी तरह से छोड़ना है, छोड़ना है, छोड़ना है, छोड़ते ही रहना है, और फिर उसके बाद आपको एक अलग प्रकार की गैस आपके शरीर में आएगी, तो आपको घबराहट हो सकती है, तो उस गैस को आपको जोर से खींचना है और तेजी से खींच के रोकना है। मैं आपको बताऊंगा उस समय आपको उसको रोक के रखना है, ठीक है। फिर 10 सेकंड तक आप सांस को रोक के रखेंगे, जब आप रोक लेंगे उसके बाद 4 सेकंड में आपको इस सांस को बाहर निकालना है और उसके बाद आपको उचित से आना है। क्या आप मेरी बात समझ गए?
Now let us start analyzing the DLCO curve. This curve is a volume time curve with volume on the y axis in liters plotted against time in seconds on the x axis. In this particular curve, after a period of deep expiration, the patient or the subject has had a deep inspiratory effort and reached 85% of the vital capacity, successfully held the breath for 10 seconds and expired it in less than 4 seconds. At the time of sample collection, there are two volumes, the washout volume and the sampling volume. The washout volume is for the washout of dead space gases and has a value of 750 to 1000 ml. And the sampling volume is used for the analysis for the values of DLCO and has a value of 500 to 1000 ml. Since the values of our subject are well within the normal limits, our curve is acceptable. The maximum number of attempts recommended for DLCO is 5 and the time between each attempt is 4 minutes. The minimum number of acceptable curves is 2, and for the repeatability criteria, the difference in DLCO should not be more than 3 milliliters of carbon monoxide per minute per millimeters of mercury, or 10%. So now let us consider the example in our subject. The two values obtained for the DLCO are well within 3 milliliters of each other, making our acceptable curves repeatable. The mean DLCO of the two acceptable maneuvers is corrected for the HB and the carboxyhemoglobin and is considered for interpretation. For example, for our subject, the value of the DLCO is 29.49 and it is well above the lower limit of normal, and so it is considered normal. The diffusion lung capacity of carbon monoxide can either be normal, decreased, or increased in patients with restrictive disease. The DLCO is low, we look at the DLCO to VA ratio. In patients with ILD, the decline in DLCO is in proportion to the decline in the alveolar volume. That means parenchymal restriction is the reason for decrease in DLCO, and hence they will have a normal DLCO to VA ratio. In patients with extra parenchymal restriction, there is a mismatch between the DLCO and the alveolar volume, leading to a high DLCO to VA ratio. Patients with coexistent pulmonary artery hypertension, the decline in DLCO is out of proportion and very severe to decline in the alveolar volume. Hence, DLCO by VA ratio is low in patients with restriction and coexistent pulmonary artery hypertension. The DLCO is normal in extra parenchymal restriction conditions like kyphoscoliosis and increased in conditions like obesity. It is used for the assessment of severity of restriction. It is divided into mild, moderate, and severe. Severe being categorized as less than 40% of predicted of DLCO, moderate of 40 to 60% predicted of DLCO, and mild being greater than 60% to less than lower limit of normal predicted of DLCO. Causes leading to low DLCO should not be forgotten. These include respiratory muscle weakness, isolated pulmonary vascular disease, and emphysema and early ILD. Causes which cause an increased DLCO include bronchial asthma, chronic bronchitis, left to right shunts, and diffuse alveolar hemorrhage. Now to recap what we learnt in the FVC maneuver. Once we perform the FVC maneuver, we first check the value of the ratio of the FEV1 it is to the vital capacity. If it is normal, we check the vital capacity. If that is normal, we consider a normal vital capacity maneuver. If after a normal FEV1 to VAC ratio, we get a reduced vital capacity, it means that there is a possible restriction. If the FEV1 by VC ratio is reduced, we check the vital capacity, and if it is normal, that means there is obstruction. And if the FEV1 by VC ratio is reduced and the vital capacity is also reduced, it means that there is either an obstruction with a possible coexistent restriction or a severe obstruction. To recap the total lung capacity, the total lung capacity can either be normal or it might be increased, which is suggestive of possible hyperinflation, or it could be reduced, which is suggestive of restriction. Before we conclude our training module, two important things that we need to stress upon are: number one, the utility of pulmonary function testing in pre-operative evaluation before lung resection. Number two, utility of pulmonary function testing in patients who are evaluated for the need of in-flight oxygen during air travel. Post-operative predicted FEV1 and DLCO are used to assess the feasibility of lobar and segmental resections. They are calculated as the predicted post-operative FEV1 is equal to the pre-operative FEV1 into 1 minus Y upon Z, where Y is the number of lung segments to be removed and Z is the total number of functional segments. The patient can be taken up for surgery if the PPO, FEV1 and DLCO is greater than 60% of that predicted. And if it is 30 to 60%, the patient has to undergo a 6-minute walk test, and less than 30%, the patient has to undergo cardiopulmonary exercise testing. Moving on to the evaluation of the need for in-flight oxygen requirement. we first check the resting saturation of the patient. If it is greater than 95%, there is no indication for in-flight oxygen requirement. If it is less than 95%, it is an indication for in-flight oxygen requirement. If it is between 92 for 95%, the risk factors for in-flight hypoxemia include the FEV1 less than 50% predicted, reduced diffusion lung capacity of carbon monoxide, a 6-minute walk distance less than 50 meters, acute exacerbation of chronic obstructive airway disease within the past 6 weeks, restrictive lung disease, and pulmonary hypertension. These risk factors automatically become an indication for in-flight oxygen requirement. To conclude, I would like to say that pulmonary function testing is widely underutilized and has a wider scope. Pre-test evaluation should be given importance prior to pulmonary function testing. The patient's performance is directly proportional to the pre-test counseling. We should always assess test performance prior to interpreting the results. PFT graphics are as important as absolute values, and always interpret results with the clinical context in mind. Thank you.